we can start, I think.
We are complete,
more or less complete. A small group compared to the first session, Joost, and we really had a lot of discussion with the audience then, and well, we try to do that now too. So all your input is welcome, because we are on the program. It says, what was it? Not learning from fires, but
explaining
fires. Yeah, using fire engineering. We tried to explain some fires that Joost saw in practice, and that was very difficult. So I think we adjusted the title to learning from fires using fire engineering. I think that title suits better for this workshop. We'll introduce ourselves first. I'm Ruud van Herpen. Normally I'm a technical director and consultant at Niemann Consultants. That I'm doing, well, let's say three and a half day a week. And the rest of the time I'm what they call a fellow fire engineering at the Eindhoven University of Technology. That's a kind of professor from the outside to make a link between the academic world of the university and the engineering world outside the university. That's very nice to do. I really like that. I think I like that better than being a consultant, to be honest. So working with students is really nice because they're open-minded, don't have any experience, and lack of experience is really an advantage when you're thinking in fire engineering. And I'm doing more or less the same as a professor of fire safety of buildings at Saxion University. That's a bachelor university in Enschede. So I work a lot with students and with master researchers and try to make a combination between that student research and the engineering practice. As I said, I like that very much. I think the combination is very nice. I'm really busy with modeling fire. That's my main job, you could say. And this is not my daily suit, of course. You understand that. This is more my daily suit. At the fire service, they always say to me, yeah, you are a scientist, but you don't know in practice how fire works, so maybe you should practice with us again sometime. So I did that in Arnhem.
It was in Arnhem, and yeah. I told him a secret. It's a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
We had an old apartment building, and we put some couches on fire for making some videos, and we put Ruud as firefighter, and they made fire in a car with a lot of wood in it, and the crew said, isn't it too hot for Ruud? No, it's
is
not.
Is this acceptable still?
So he didn't know that, and also
I didn't know that.
He was allowed to extinguish the fire, but they give not a small hose, but a big hose. So it was very heavy. So
yeah, it was
not fair for Ruud, but we had a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was not fair to me. I thought, well, it's really a heavy job being a firefighter because of all the material that you have to draw with you. Okay, Joost.
Now, I'm Joost Ebers. For the people who know me, I talk a lot and very fast, but today this presentation is in English, so yeah, it's a little
that
bit slower.
That slows you down,
it's
slows
bad
you down
for
yeah.
you, I think. But I work here at the Institute for Safety as a researcher advisor, and I'm still a fire investigator for the fire region of Gelderland Midden. That's the region we are in here now. And I'm also a volunteer crew commander at the city of Nijmegen, that's a city nearby by Arnhem. And yesterday I was talking, I was here too long because I was 3 minutes too late for a very nice big fire in the city. So when I was going back, I thought, oh, but no problem.
This is during the experiments, I think.
Oh, that's another experience of cooling down smoke layers.
Okay.
Now, why did we take Ruud in a real fire? Because a lot of people are telling us how to make buildings safe. And I think when you have never experienced smoke or heat or know what a fire crew must do to go in and to rescue somebody, yeah, it's hard to talk about it. So that's why we took Ruud with us.
Yeah.
But as a fire investigator, I see a lot of fires. And here at the Fire Service Academy, Ricardo made a report about the renewed... sorry, I have to get my paper with it. Sorry for that. Renewed view on firefighting.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I asked Ruud, can we give a presentation about fire engineering and look to fires and use some calculation?
Yeah, I think a very logical question, Joost, because fire engineering we normally use for preventive measures in buildings. That's how we are really, really familiar with fire engineering to do that. And to make project-specific solutions, we call that project-specific solutions. But if you use fire engineering for preventive measures, maybe you can also use fire engineering for repressive measures, and or maybe to make suppression more effective, or maybe to use the preventive measures that we made in the building also for fire suppression. So that means that. For fire suppression, then we also need to know what kind of fire is there in the building when we arrive as a fire service. And that depends, of course, on the type of building and on the fire load and the type of fuel in the building. So you need to know something about building characteristics and fire characteristics. And we will see, we have two different cases. You see that it's very difficult, especially the fire characteristics, to tell something about fire and fuel characteristics when you arrive as a fire service and the fire is still inside the building. It's hard to see the fire and it's hard to recognize those characteristics. But we'll try if something is possible. So that's what we do, and therefore we use what we call a natural fire concept. So we don't use the standard fire curve because that doesn't make sense for real fires. And a natural fire concept comes closer to real fires than the standard fire curve. That is why we use that natural fire concept. I think a short list of building characteristics that might be important also for fire suppression to make your strategy or your tactics. You can imagine that an important building characteristic is the geometry and the dimensions of the fire compartment. Is it a large compartment? Is it a high compartment? Or is it a small compartment or low? But also, what kind of external separation constructions do we have? Is it very well insulated, or do we have a lot of mass? That means that there is a lot of heat accumulation, cooling down the gas mass to the external separation constructions. Are there daylight openings that are not fire resistant and maybe they are go open with already a low temperature? That are important characteristics about the building envelope that you need to know. And also, I think the air tightness, well, maybe for industrial compartments, not a real big issue, but for small compartments, really the air tightness is also an issue of external separation construction. And then I showed it to Joost and asked Joost, well, is that possible to recognize or to summarize those characteristics for fire service, for the firefighters? And then Joost said, well, that's quite a lot that we need to know.
Yeah, it's difficult. And
difficult,
we
yes.
are going to two cases, and Ruud will ask you to answer the questions for the real cases. But we want to know, can we see from the outside some more of what's happening inside. And we talked about air tightness, but sometimes you see that a building is reacting on the fire and is moving a little bit, so it's creating his own ventilation.
Yeah.
And because the metal is
bending, it's cracking,
more openings come, and the fire gets bigger and bigger and bigger. But we also got buildings that is so airtight, we don't see anything, nothing comes out. And that's where we are going to talk about.
Yeah, and then I think even more complicated than the building characteristics are the fire and fuel characteristics, because, do we know something about the fire load inside the building? Sometimes you know, because when we're talking about the cases that we have are industrial buildings, and we took industrial buildings because then you can expect anything when it comes to fire load. When it's a production building, the fire load isn't normally not very high. But when it's a storage building, you can have very high fire loads. So you can expect anything. But maybe you know, because you know, well, you know the owner, whatever, or you know, you are familiar with the industrial area, and you know what kind of industrial building it is. So that's important, the fuel, the fire load, but yeah, then also the type of fuel, especially because of the rate of heat release that you can expect, but also if it's a uniform fire load, then you get an expanding fire normally, but when it's a localized fire load, then maybe it's only a short peak in the rate of heat release curve. You see that there are different questions. And I think especially if it's a uniform fire load or a localized fire load is very important. And in both cases, you can define a slow, medium, fast, or ultra-fast fire development. And then when a fire is developing, what is the rate of heat release density that you can expect? Is it low? That's more or less a smoldering fire. Normal? What's normal? Yeah. Okay, that's normal according to the building code. So that's, let's say, 1 kilogram per square meter per minute, what burns down. Or is it a high rate of heat release per unit area? This is more difficult to say something about that.
If we look at a renewed view on firefighting from Ricardo Weber, I don't know if everybody knows the piece, but there we have, that's Ruud, you have to help me. Vuistregels.
Rules of thumb. Rules of thumb.
Thank you very much. It's for how normal houses. It's normal. Thus, you can say if my living of my bedroom is 10 square meters.
Yeah, this goes.
I have
this
2.5 megawatts on energy.
I think this is correct for almost any building function. Yeah. Except
for
the industrial. Yeah.
We got this one. So that's how we teach our crew commanders or officers to calculate if they have to guess how big is the fire, how much water do I need, they use.
Okay,
that.
If you teach them that, then they expect this too.
Always.
Yeah. Oh, in the worst case. Okay. Well, I try to do some simulations in a very simple zone model because we only have very simple characteristics, so I cannot use any advanced model for that. For some cases of that Joost showed to me, and then I have to give a kind of definition what I mean with a rate of heat release curve, a T-squared curve, with a slow, medium, fast, or ultra-fast development, and also what I mean with a localized fire with a slow, medium, or fast development. So that's on this slide. So this is a bit technical slide. You see on the horizontal axis, that's the time axis here. In seconds, and on the vertical axis you see the rate of heat release in megawatts, and maybe you're familiar with this T-squared curve because that are the design scenarios that we use in fire engineering also for preventive measures. But you see also that there is a real gap between the curves, so there's a lot of uncertainty in the rate of heat release scenarios.
But Ruud, when we have a fire in a storage building with storing racks in it, we can expect this because the fire goes up.
Yeah, you can expect an ultra fast fire. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, normally. Yeah. And when it's a localized fire, what you see in fire in only one object is that you reach a kind of peak in the rate of heat release, and then it's a little bit smoldering down, but remains on a certain level. So I defined three peak curves. Fast, medium, and slow. The fast with the highest peak of six megawatts of an object fire, and then smoldering in 2 megawatts. And the medium, 4.5, and the slow to 3 megawatts. And you see that also the slope is different. And the slope is important because when you have a steep curve, that means that also the temperature development is very increasing very rapidly. And that might create high overpressure in compartments. So that's why not only the peak is different, but also the slope the curve is different in this case. So, okay, this is only very roughly. But it gives me some input for calculating.
When we arrive at the fire scene, we will, you can see it now. Press the button once, I think.
Yeah. I don't know where. Yeah.
Spatie. Okay.
Oh. No, that's Democrat. That's Democrat.
It's automatic playing, I think.
Automatic play, yeah.
Okay. When we arrive at the scene, we can see different things. We see a building with nothing coming out of it. There's a fire inside now. Okay, it's not a moving image, but there's a fire inside. We have this garage where the smoke, black smoke, slowly is coming out of the building. We got, and this one I like more than the above, a building where gray, yellow smoke is pushed out with a little power behind it, and you know what to expect. It's coming. We don't know when or where, but this fire took 3 hours before the flames were bursting out of the roof. Or this fire, before you arrive, you see flames coming out of the roof. And this picture was made.
You arrived too late. So you don't stop anymore, but you just drive.
Okay. But this picture is made 6 minutes after somebody left the building. So we know it was a very fast fire. But those two, we know what's going to happen. And sometimes this one is when the white smoke is coming out very slow, maybe we have a chance. But when there's pressure behind it, we know there's something going on inside.
Maybe you don't know exactly what's going to happen, but you know what you should do here. And the first two are more complicated.
And we are going to talk about the first two.
Yeah. Because maybe now the movie starts again.
Yeah. Oh, I've got to tell something. Sorry. When we look at the fires, we know that the ingredients are there from the fire triangle. Temperature, we got fuel, and we got oxygen, but we don't know if it's the right mixture. So if you open it up, you never know what to expect. And I wanted to know, Ruud, can we see from the outside what's happening inside to get some clues? Can we open it or should we keep it closed until we are ready to...
in general a difficult question, and this is a garage for this kind of
telehandlers. I didn't know the word, but no.
And here you saw, I think that's the next slide, that the smoke is coming out.
This kind of building is in every city in
it's a very common building.
In the region we are in now, Gelderland-Midden, this year we had 2 fires in that kind of buildings. So I think in a lot of cities, a garage like this could be a car garage or repair, for buses trucks. We have a lot in the Netherlands.
So with overhead doors here you see...
Who is a firefighter in the room?
Okay.
Who is an officer? Fire officer? Fire officer, it is good to know. And we got a commander. Yeah. Hoofdofficier van dienst. Nobody? Okay. Who is a crew commander? Nobody?
No.
Okay. Yeah. question. If you... Look at this aerial overview.
Yeah, this is the roof of the garage, what you see here. Yeah.
What do you see? Do you see something that can be of importance or not?
Well, what I see is a standalone building.
Yeah.
Maybe you have to protect a building nearby, but it's pretty empty around the building. But if you look at the roof, what do you see?
You have the lighting
Yeah.
Daylight openings or windows, I don't know how you call it.
Daylight openings.
But later on, when we see a picture of this fire, okay, you click back, Ruud. The sound is coming again, but no problem.
No, not here.
One more back.
Okay.
Yeah, if you look at this one, yeah, it's coming from the big doors, and nothing is coming out of the roof. So sometimes it's very important to look at the aerial of the air picture. Yes, it can tell you something about
exactly.
the temperature. So as a firefighter, we need to learn to look at the building and really understand what we see. And if now you send your crew out, say, okay, go around the building and tell me what you see, I think a lot of persons don't know where they have to look for. Yeah, we want to see where's the fire, but there's more to see than only the fire. But if when you arrive at the scene, sometimes some fire crews only have a couple of fires a year. And when you have a fire like that, it's, oh, we have a fire, and you forget some things. Oh, I have to come to you with a microphone, or else somebody is getting angry with me.
Is it on?
Yeah, and close by.
Oh, is there a firewall between the garage and the office?
Yeah.
No. The crew ran around it and said there's no smoke in the garage. But normally in the Netherlands, if you see how big it is, it's about 1,000 square meters, I think.
Yeah,
normally you have a firewall.
No, it's smaller
about
than
30
thousand.
Minutes. So. Yeah. But the firewalls in the Netherlands are there for personal safety to get everybody out. In the end, everything is allowed to burn down.
Yeah. Because here you see the floor plan, and I think it's the compartment 30 meters by 24, something like that. So it's 750, 800 square meters. And we expect, I don't see it in this picture, but apparently, it's not, you cannot see it very clear, but there is a fire-resistant wall between the office function and the industrial function. Okay, so this is basically the floor plan. Well, then the first question: if you maybe I have to go back to this picture here. If we take a look at the building, what do you think about the external separation construction? Is that a thermal light or a thermal heavy construction? A thermal light construction is a construction that has not enough mass to absorb any energy from the gas inside. And a thermal heavy construction is a construction that has enough mass to absorb energy from the gas mass. So then the gas mass is cooling down to the external separation construction. For me, with the natural concept, that's important. That's important information. in this case, what do you expect? Thermal light, yeah. I expect that too, because I think it's kind of sandwich panel cladding, whatever it is, but a thermal light construction. Is it a very airtight construction, in your opinion? No, that's in industrial buildings are hardly airtight. So that it's well insulated. I'm not sure. Yeah, I think so. It's kind of sandwich panel construction. It surely is
working
well insulated.
There, and it's freezing. It's freezing inside, so it must be. But can you go back, Ruud, for a minute? When you
back
have
to what
the picture where you were talking about with the one. If you arrive at the fire scene and you don't see anything because it's black smoke, maybe somebody could use street view. And if you look at the picture now, you could see a lot of the building inside of the building, and this can tell you more than the view you have when you arrive. There's a fire. It's now. I see it now. I think. Oh, when you look at the building now, you see more than the picture sheet later on. This maybe if you have time and we talk about that, then you can use everything you have with you. And I think a lot of firefighters have a telephone in their pocket when they.
Okay, so that's a new idea.
Yeah, new idea. Yeah. Only for this case.
Only for this case. Okay, so this is thermal light. It's well insulated, and it's not an airtight building. And then we have openings in the roof. You saw that, the daylight openings in the roof. But you see that also in the facade, in the overhead doors. We have also kind of transparent openings, but it's like something like polycarbonate or something. It's not glass, but it's also a plastic type of material. So that means that openings that are, well, we don't know exactly, of course, but let's say somewhere between 100 and 200 degrees Celsius, they will melt or they will open. So what you see in this case when you arrive, that they are still closed. That says something about the smoke temperature inside. Okay. So we filled in this building characteristics. Then the fuel characteristics are more complicated. I think you can have some discussion about if this is a cellulose fire or a hydrocarbon fire. But let's assume normal cellulose fire. Then the next question is the fire load uniformly distributed or is the localized fire load? Well, what do we expect in this case? When you saw the telehandlers, the machines inside, localized, that's what we expect. So we start here too, the simulations with the localized fire load. And the fire development, I think no one knows. So I started just with, I think, a medium fire development for that localized fire load with a normal rate of heat release density. So. Yeah.
Would you imagine it was a fast development?
Maybe if the
That's problem. We don't know if there's a lot of fuel involved. Maybe the fuel tank is catching fire. We have can go fast.
In this case, the definition of fast is this curve, so that it is not the uniformly distributed fire load, but it is this localized fire.
Localized fire, and it might be fast, but it doesn't spread very fast.
If you compare that with a car park fire, then is this a really a large peak already with a steep slope. So I think this might be suitable for this kind of storage here in this garage.
Okay, but now we arrive. Question. Sorry about the question.
I must one thing is assessing the external part of the building. You said it's a sandwich panel, but what kind of sandwich panel?
That we don't know.
But if we arrive at the scene and you see smoke coming out of the, there's no smoke over here, and when you walk around and you see smoke, you see cracking or openings and smoke is coming out, then you know the insulation
might
be on fire.
Almost on fire. Yeah.
And I got another case where you see the paint coming off, falling down. If you see the paint falling down, it says something about the situation inside. So we have to learn to. Ricardo is away. He was in, but he's in the gun now. But he says, stop and think. What do I see? And what we do in practice, as a fire investigator, I see a lot of videos of fires, including this one. They arrive, and what they do is not stop and think, no, stop, and we have to get in as fast as possible without thinking how dangerous is it.
Yeah. So this is when you
arrive at the scene, black smoke is coming out slowly. What do you do? And I go to the back. There's some firefighters. What do you do?
Stop and think.
Okay, and where are we going to think about?
That's the right first step.
The next step.
The next step.
What's the next step?
Circle around.
Yeah.
So you have a view from all sides.
Okay.
Okay, and where?
But everything.
Where do you look for?
If there is something, a fire going already outside, or if there's only just the black smoke
Okay. Only black smoke, sorry. Yeah. When we arrive at the scene, we want to know where is the fire, what is on fire, and can we reach it? And Ricardo's story is, we prefer to reach it from the outside. Yeah. Because when we go inside, it might be dangerous for ourselves. But we circled around.
Yeah. You didn't see anything.
And we didn't see anything. So what we can see is smoke everywhere there's smoke. On the other side there's smoke. There's no smoke in the other building. But you made your circle. You tell your crew commander, only thing we see is smoke. I don't know where the fire is. You are a fire officer? Yeah. I'm the 110. I'm the crew commander. My crew circled around. And the only thing they see is black smoke. The other side is the same as this. What are we going to do? It's very nice, eh, to ask the question. The monkey is now for my, it's on your shoulder.
Is there someone inside?
No, it's closed. Oh, sorry, I forgot to tell. 7 o'clock in the night, it is closed. Nobody's there. Everything is locked down.
I will say an office, offensive inzet van buitenaf.
Okay, we attack the fire from the outside.
Yeah, but you don't know where the fire is.
Where is the fire? What are we going to do? Problem. Because
there's take the risk to go in.
Okay, we don't go in. But what are we going to do? Because it's now a half an hour later, still the same situation. I get somebody is wants to help. Yeah. The skylights are still in and. The doors are still intact.
You can see there's a little bit of heat because the windows are
That's normal because the windows are not flat.
This is normal.
A little bit
so
curved.
That's not to do with the heat.
Heat map.
What do you infrared camera? Okay, when we look with a thermal image camera at a building like this. Because of the walls are there, we only see the places where the smoke is coming out. You see a little bit of heat over there. But when the walls are very well...
Maybe you can estimate the temperature of the smoke then.
Yeah, of the smoke, but not...
Okay.
And in this case,
that might be possible.
Nothing special was seen. And now is the problem, what are we going to do? Are we opening...
Maybe we can just open the door.
Okay, open the door. We can wait. Okay. 2 hours later, it's still the same. What are we going to do? Yeah, okay, order coffee and sandwiches. Okay, everything is arrived. Well. SBS, NOS, everything is there. CNN, everything you want.
Joost, let me first help you, because if you wait half an hour, then in 5 minutes I've done a simulation. And I can give you some more information based on what we've seen on building characteristics and fuel characteristics. So I did that simulation with, the charts that we filled in.
We can call you when we have a fire. Yeah, we send you a picture and he make the calculation for us.
Yeah. Okay, now you just fill in. You give me the information and I do the calculation. So I did simulation with the thermal light separation construction, well insulated, not very airtight. A cellulose fire localized with medium development and a rate of heat release density of 250 kilowatts per square meter, and everything is closed. So you see here openings open at 200 degrees Celsius, but if they don't reach that temperature, everything remains closed. This is the rate of heat release that we that localized scenario with peak rate of heat release after 3 minutes.
Go back for a minute, because Ricardo's story, the renewed view on firefighting, he says when you have less than 2.5 megawatts, less than one couch on fire, you can go in with high pressure, or not?
Yeah, but it's not less than 2.5 megawatts, Joost.
We arrive.
Afterwards, yeah.
But we don't know, Root is
You don't know. You don't know. No, this is an assumption for the fire scenario. But what you see is that it's a fuel controlled scenario. There is enough oxygen, although the separation construction is closed. There is no reduction in the rate of heat release. So that means that there is enough oxygen available for combustion. And these are the resulting temperatures. The hot layer, approximately 80 degrees, and the cold layer underneath, let's say between 25 and 30 degrees Celsius. Oh, temperatures are very low. And that corresponds that the daylight openings in the roof and in the facade are still intact, because the temperatures are that low that there is no opening at all.
When my crew is going in?
Yeah.
It's just normal sunny day, 25 degrees. Yeah. I'm warmer inside of my gear than outside. It's outside of my gear.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's normal, and also the radiation flux coming from the hot zone is less than 1 kilowatt per square meter, so
we don't feel anything.
That.
If we go inside,
yeah,
only black smoke.
It looks like cold smoke, yeah.
Okay.
Well, there is, here you see the interface development, so the hole is, internal height is about 6 meter, I think, as I see here. And then you see in time that the smoke-free height becomes less, and eventually, let's say, well, between 2 and 2.5 meter. That's not exactly what we saw.
Oh, it was below 1 meter. So, yeah. Ruud,
yeah.
I think maybe you have too much ventilation in the building than there
that's
is
possible.
In reality.
That's possible. Maybe it's a bit more airtight than I assumed. That's a possibility. And also the fire load, or the start of the fire in this simulation was at 1 meter above floor level. So that maybe when it's exactly floor level, you get a little bit other development of the smoke layer. So yeah, but that's always difficulty. A model is never the reality. Yeah? So but also in the model, you see that there is a large smoke mass, a huge smoke mass with a bit of low temperature. That corresponds with what you saw in practice.
And we look at the temperature of the smoke layer. We are taught as fire crews to go in and put some water in the smoke layer and watch if the water is coming down or not. But when we have this kind of temperatures and we use the low pressure because of the height of the building, every water drop, almost everything is coming down again. And what does it say? Is it safe or not? I don't know.
You don't need to cool the smoke layer.
But I don't know when I go in how hot the smoke is. And when I put
put some water
in it, I can see is it hot or not.
But can't you feel the heat of the smoke then, the radiation flux?
I don't know, because this is an average temperature you have. And I always was learned hot gases are on the top, cold gases are on the bottom. So that's a little bit of a problem.
Yeah. Okay. So, but what you see in this case, what happens when you think about this rate of heat scenario and this kind of temperatures, what would happen if you open a door? Is there any risk of that the fire is would increase? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you think so? Yeah. Why?
Okay.
Because we suppose that I'm right and that it's only a localized fire, and this is at the rate of heat release that is developed. And it's still a fuel-controlled fire. That means that there is no lack of oxygen. When I open the door, okay, then there can be more oxygen, but more oxygen doesn't influence my rate of heat release scenario.
Oh, wait a minute. I have to use the microphone.
How do you conclude that it's a fuel-controlled fire?
We don't know.
You don't know, but I know.
Yeah, he knows. He knows the end of the fire, so it's a little bit cheating. Yeah. But we have to... we try to look, can we use this kind of calculations to see something?
Yeah, I don't show you all the graphs, but the rate of heat release computed as here, that is the rate of heat release. There is no reduction of rate of heat release. That means that there is enough oxygen, and also check that with the oxygen mass in the compartment. And there is still, during the whole fire scenario, there's oxygen available in the compartment. So there is. That means that if you allow more oxygen to flow in, that doesn't influence my rate of heat in this scenario. So that's basically not the case. So it's possible to open a door without any consequences, I think. Okay, so this is a summary of the simulation results. Fuel-controlled fire. There is no high overpressure in the compartment. That's because it's not an airtight compartment. A low interface height between the hot zone and the cold zone. And also a low temperature, so openings remain intact. Visibility might be poor, well, especially in the smoke layer, but also underneath the smoke layer, because the smoke-free height is not very comfortable. It's not very large. And my conclusion is that opening of the overhead doors is possible, and maybe it's also needed for smoke ventilation. Okay. Maybe then you can gain some
sight.
But
we can only do this if we are...
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
That this is the situation, and when I arrive as a crew commander, I see this, and I don't know what's inside, so that's still tricky, Ruud, to open the door.
Of course. So we see what if
okay. Let's open the door.
Okay. Let's open the door.
Oh,
the first one.
Black smoke is coming out?
Cruise. Yeah.
Oh, they only have high pressure. Low pressure is not ready yet. Okay, we are learned when we open something like that. We have low pressure hoses ready with water on it, but high pressure hose and smoke is coming out.
Yeah.
But we don't see anything. This we can see you the smoke see layer goes down, but smoke is coming out. Not with a lot of pressure, but you can see.
You can see that because it's immediately rising out of the opening. Yeah. So yeah.
Okay. Ruud, we open another door.
Yeah.
Another door is opened. Uh-oh. And you can see the smoke layer is still 2 meters.
Yeah. Yeah. It's still very thick.
Oh, yeah. You can see here it's higher. That Ruud, you have to move a little. Sorry. But you can see here the smoke. Here, smoke is here higher, lower. Maybe that tells you something about the location of the fire. But the fire crews go in and they use a thermal imaging camera and they cannot look through the smoke. Oh. Because of the soot particles inside of the smoke, the thermal imaging camera doesn't work.
Yeah,
and every practice we do in buildings, it works and we see everything. But in reality, a lot of times, we don't see anything.
No, I think in smoke you cannot see, but an infrared camera.
We see a lot, but when there's a lot of black smoke, we get some troubles.
Okay.
But let's open another door, Ruud.
Okay.
The third one. I forgot to tell you, when I showed the first picture to a couple of colleagues of mine here at the Fire Service Academy, they said, oh, the fire is coming. I can see it. We had the movie of the fire. Say, oh, this one is going to get very big, this fire. So it is very difficult to, when you show pictures to people or videos to people, we always think, oh, we know, we think we have a lot of experience and we know what is going to happen, but it's very difficult.
And I think they say that because they made the assumption that it's not a localized fire inside.
Yeah, I don't know it.
That there was a risk of an expanding fire inside. Yeah. Okay. Well, the third, I think already the third or the fourth.
Yeah, and we saw some gas bottles, a little bit dangerous, so we took them out. And then, Ruud, next picture. Yeah, we open everything. Hey, we see something left in the back. Yeah, you don't see it over here, but next picture. And this is what was on fire.
Yeah.
And what we do is we make everything ready for the big fire and then we start to open doors. But when you have this as the end result, everybody who was there says, oh, next time we can open it sooner because this is the situation. Yeah. But the problem is we don't know that when we start fighting the fire. And that's, well, when you have done something like this and this is the result, next time you do the same, alleen only you open the doors earlier.
Yeah.
It might be different, but Ruud, you said we have an average smoke layer of 200 degrees, then openings are being made. But when the truck or the car is on fire above the ceiling, it's getting hotter than the 200 degrees. Sometimes you get lucky or not get lucky. I don't know if you want big flames or not, but if you get lucky, the roof openings partly. Yeah. Open.
This is not a picture from that.
No, it's not. This is another situation.
Just another situation.
But
when
you have an average smoke layer, locally? Nay, what's the word?
Yeah, you have local higher temperatures, especially in the fire axis, in the fire plume. The temperatures are higher than in the rest of the smoke layer, and it might be possible that you also have this kind of localized damage. So that means that partly the roof openings are open.
We've got to tell when you go watch the roof with a thermal image camera. A lot of people think when I watch from above, I see the roof. We can see a lot of things, but the roof is the best. Is the place with the biggest layer.
The highest insulation layer. Yeah.
Insulation. Yeah. So it's difficult to look through it. But when you have openings or other materials coming out of the roof, maybe it gives you a clue of where the fire might be.
Yeah. So
what happens if
what
it goes
happens
open?
Here, here's here that local influence that the daylight openings in the roof are partly open yet because of the higher temperatures in the plume in the fire axis. And are there really many consequences when you think that opening a door hasn't any, doesn't have consequences, then openings in the roof, I'm not sure. I think that the consequences are very little. And so I simulated that in this case, 20% of the daylight opening after 3 minutes is open because of localized influences. You see in the temperature graphs that there is a little effect on the temperature of the hot zone. Yeah. Oh yeah, I have it. Because it's a little bit lower than in the first simulation. So that's I think a positive influence. What you see on the thickness of the smoke layer too, that the interface is a bit higher than in the first simulation, so there is apparently a loss of mass because of the opening in the roof. That's also a nice thing. So this localized influence isn't a bad influence in this case, not for a localized fire.
If I want to make a roof opening on the roof and I open it up, it might be very dangerous. When we see the videos of the US, sometimes you get scared of what they are doing. But if we don't know what's happening inside,
yeah,
and we make an opening, yeah, if we get lucky, we get some. We can look under the smoke layer.
Yeah.
But if we are not lucky, we activate the fire, and we are.
Yeah, you could activate a fire just like opening a door when it's a fire load that is much larger than this fire load, or when it's more when it's uniformly distributed, so that there is an expanding fire possible. But that was here not the case. So this is not a very exciting result, basically. Then another question is, suppose that you have a very airtight building. I think in industrial buildings that is not that's not very common, not a normal situation. But okay, let's suppose that we have an airtight external separation construction. Then I would expect overpressure in the compartment in case of fast increasing rate of heat release. And in small compartments, this effect is already well known. And then you think about dwellings, residential functions with small compartments, there we encounter this problem. Because then you see a high overpressure in the compartment and you cannot open your front door anymore because the pressure is too high on the door. In industrial buildings with large volumes, this is not very much the case, but okay. What we see here, there you see the pressure at floor level and in time. You see after 3 minutes, you see the peak in the pressure about 650-700 pascals. So that's really a storm overpressure. But I think when you arrive, Joost, at the scene, then the peak is already gone. There is no peak
anymore.
We had
an example. I think a couple of you have seen the video of a fire in Kootwijkerbroek. It's a little village, and there was a fire. And we have the security camera images from the outside. And we see this happening. But when the overpressure is there, a lot of black smoke is coming out of the building, and when you arrive at the scene and you see that, you say, hey, it's a very big fire, I need some more trucks. But when the pressure is gone, the smoke is away, nothing to see, and you see just a building with a little bit of smoke coming out of it. So it's if you are lucky and you arrive or you drive by and you see this, the smoke, you can see if the building is airtight or not.
Can hear it then.
You can hear it very loud.
You can hear the smoke coming out, yeah. The consequences are not very big on the temperatures, as you can see. You see a bit higher temperature in the hot layer, and that's because the airtight building in this case means that the airtightness is 100 times better as a normal building. So that means that we really keep all the smoke mass inside the building. That leads to a little bit higher temperatures in the smoke layer. But not to other consequences, I think, in this case. What's happening then after 8 minutes? I'll show you this one. Here you see the development of the smoke layer. And you see that after, let's say 8 minutes, and the smoke-free height is that low that we assume that it's a mixed situation, and that's what you see in this graph too. Here you see the temperature of the gold zone, and here the temperature of the hot zone, and from this point, from 8 minutes, it's more or less a mixed zone, so that's the temperature what you see here of in the mixed situation. I think not very different from the case that was a normal case, I think, Joost.
But I do know, when you arrive at a building and you see smoke coming out of the building at a lot of places, that's something you know about the airtightness.
Yeah.
And if the building is not airtight, you know ook air is going in. And that tells you something about is it possible for the fire to continue, yeah. Yes or no?
Yeah.
And if it is possible for the fire to grow, to get bigger, you should see it in how the smoke is coming out of the building. Yeah. Is it only coming out or sometimes going in again? So we still have to look at the smoke, but how much smoke you see tells you something about the airtightness of the building.
Yeah, and then again, if fire can develop because of it's not an airtight building, then we come basically to this last situation. Suppose that it's not a localized fire, but that it's a fire in something like a rec storage. No, it's not a rec storage, I think. But okay, let's say a kind of storage building. So it's a uniformly distributed fire load, and that means that fire development is always possible. The building fire characteristics are basically the same as in a normal case, except for the fire. It's uniformly distributed with a fast development, so a time constant of 150 seconds. So after 2.5 minutes, I have a 1 megawatt fire with a rate of heat release density 250 kilowatt per square meter. I did then the simulation, and then you see that we get a flashover. Here you see the temperature graphs. And after, let's say, 8-9 minutes, you see that the temperature rises quickly, and that means that from that point off we have a flashover. And maybe we go to the rate of heat release graph. Already far before flashover, you remember the temperature criterion for the daylight openings, about 200 degrees Celsius, so that's something here. That means that before flashover already, roof openings, daylight openings will fill, will become real openings. And that's why in this case, you see that even after flashover, the fire is still fuel controlled. So that's a very specific situation, I think. Because here you see the rate of heat release in time, and you see that at the moment of flashover, you see a quick rise in the rate of heat release, but you see that the rate of heat release after flashover is the same as the rate of heat release in the free burn situation. And that means that there is no reduction, and that means that there is no lack of fuel, no lack of oxygen. So still a fuel controlled fire. I think in the next case, you see a completely different scenario. In most cases, this is a very unique scenario. In most cases, you see after flashover that the fire is oxygen controlled. Sorry, I'm still standing for the slides, I think.
Okay. I look at the time. Maybe we skip this one and go to the...
Well, we have time until?
Quarter to five,
I think.
Five, so yeah, we are a little bit behind.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
I talk a little bit slowly because it is in English.
Yeah.
Normally I'm a little
maybe
bit faster.
Yeah. Okay. It's good to mention the consequences for the fire service, Joost, in this case, because here you can practically do nothing except for saving the neighboring plots, so cooling down the neighboring plots.
We saw the four buildings with the four fires. It was the fire that
basically
was over here.
Yeah.
Flames coming out of it. Yeah. Very nice fire. Half an hour later, we are a little bit, not over yet, and we have to wait. So.
Yeah. And you can almost see it when you arrive if you have to deal with this scenario. So that's okay.
But unfortunately, not a lot of buildings are built now in the Netherlands with
daylight openings in
daylight
the roof.
Because of water getting in and burglars getting in. So that's why they don't do that anymore, and that's why we got more and more problems when we arrive at the fire scene.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, what important is, I think, when you arrive is to recognize if you have to deal with a pre-flash over fire or a post-flash over fire. Especially in a post-flash over fire, it's important to have an idea if the fire is fuel controlled or oxygen controlled, and in most cases it will be oxygen controlled. And if it is oxygen controlled, that's also in theory possible in a pre-flash over fire, but then you should have already a very large rate of heat release, a very large fire. If you have an oxygen controlled fire, then there are consequences when you create openings in these separation constructions, because then that would have impact on the rate of heat release. Because an oxygen controlled fire means that the rate of heat release is reduced by lack of oxygen. So if you supply oxygen by creating an opening, then the rate of heat release will rise, will increase. And that would have immediate consequences for gas temperatures and also for mass transport from the fire, from the fuel, to the hot zone, or visibility in a mixed situation. So there is not a standard strategy, I think, but maybe you can do something when you recognize the building characteristics and fire characteristics, and then you can have an idea about the impact of creating openings in separation construction. That's very important, because if you can create openings, then maybe you can localize the fire, or you can do something about smoke ventilation, and you can maybe you can do something to stop the fire then.
If you make openings, think about the place where you do it, because when it gets an uncontrolled fire and the fire comes out at the place you don't want it, or it's dangerous for the building next to it, you have a problem. So you still have to think, where do I make the opening? Okay. The other fire, the fire crew is on the roof, but it was later on in the incident, but they arrived at the scene. It was an automatic fire alarm that went to a private dispatch center, and somebody went there, a security guy, and said, "Hey, I see smoke in this room. There's smoke. I don't want to go inside that one. I call the fire brigade." The fire brigade is called. There's fire. You arrive at the scene and you see a building without any smoke.
Yeah.
If we go to the next slide.
Yeah, this
it's very airtight building, because nowhere there's smoke coming out. But this is the hall, number 3. About 1,200 square meters, and it's built for the building regulations in Dutch, Beheersbeheer van Brand, or the NEN 6060, and they have double doors. That means you have a fire door, a little bit space, and then another fire door. And that's for smoke coming out, it's an extra barrier to come out. This one is double.
Okay.
Double door, and also a double door.
Yeah.
Hall 3, yeah. The fire is on hall 3.
Yeah,
and
that's the
I know, but it's told, the security guy is there.
We have a fire alarm
and you can
coming
see
from hall
3. Here you can walk around, here you can rock around, here you can rock walk around, and over there, there's smoke. Okay. Fire crew opens the door, and you see black smoke until on the floor.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Yeah, you open the door, everywhere smoke is coming out. You're also a firefighter? No? Okay. Okay, you open the door. You see black smoke coming out. And you can, no, I don't see anything. What are you going to do?
Put a step back.
Okay, and then?
I use the thermal image to, if there's a possibility to see anything.
No, you don't see anything. You see nothing. Later on I tell the story what's happened, but you really don't see anything.
Smoke is coming out, so you can do an estimation of the heat, because it's coming out. And
okay, I don't feel anything. They told me, I put the gloves off, nothing special.
Yeah, it's a very big hall, so it could be a danger to go inside.
And that's the problem. Yeah. We don't know what's inside. But if you open a door, you might see something about the smoke that's coming out. Yeah. How fast is it coming out? Is it more and more? Is it hot or is it not hot?
Yeah.
When you open the door like this and you see air sucked in, please close the door.
Yeah.
But I wasn't allowed to show the video, but we got a video not of this incident, the other incident with a helm camera. And they opened the door and you could see the air is sucked inside. But they are watching it. And, oh, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. Yeah, it's very beautiful. But when they walk back, they see what happened. There's a fire, a very big fire. They activated the fire. And fortunately, the fire wasn't coming their way. But sometimes if you open the door, this.
Yeah.
But in this case, it was a very localized fire. It was eight pallets.
Euro pallets?
With boxes on it. On fire, the fire started in a big plastic waste bin on wheels. They cleaned a truck and there was some fish oil inside. And when you have fish oil, it might be something with self-heating. And 72 hours after they cleaned the truck, the fire started in the waste bin. It's on video, but we weren't allowed to show the video, so that's why we don't have the video. But it's very localized.
Yeah,
very and localized the problem was here that it was inked from printers. So if you could you see through the smoke because of the printer inked in the smoke? They couldn't see anything. And a day later, there was still black printer inked flying around in the building.
Okay, so it was a very localized fire in this case with a very small fire load, but it could also be a very large fire load because this is basically the storage building we're talking about. It's rack storage. So, but it's almost empty. So they were very lucky in this case. It could also be a completely different fire.
They told us that the next day or the next week it might be full with stuff. What kind of stuff? It could be anything except dangerous goods because they weren't allowed to store it there.
Yeah.
Okay. You can see the one back. You can see the openings they made to try to ventilate the building because it was full of smoke, but because of the printer inked, it didn't work because it was lying on the floor. You can also see it over here.
Yeah.
And when you use ventilators or what, you throw it in the air again and it gets worse. Oh yeah, 12 firefighters' gears were thrown away because of the black inked inside of it. They cleaned it, but it didn't work.
Okay.
And because we want to use clean suit gear, and it was totally black, they throw it away.
Okay, so I hear. I think. Well, let's do another simulation with also a simple zone model. This is a thermal light construction, well insulated. There are no openings at all here, and it's it's not really airtight. There are some openings because of building elements, but we can fill this in very simple. And now we know something about the fire and the fuel. Yeah, okay, it's a cellulose fire, localized fire load with only a very limited fire load. I think here I took also medium fire development. I'm not sure about that with a normal rate of heat release density. And then performed the simulations with the summary of the boundary conditions. You see again low temperatures in the hot zone and both in the hot zone and the cold zone, very low temperatures. Also, a peak temperature and temperature afterwards is decreasing.
But Ruud, because of it was a fire about, I think, 9 square meters.
Yeah.
But because the building is high and around 1,200 square meters, you get a lot of cubic meters, and that's why the average temperature is low.
Yeah.
But people forget when we go in buildings like that. That a fire can be big without you noticing it because of the temperature of the smoke layer.
Yeah. So this is a very small fire with very low temperatures and also enough smoke-free height. Well, that's not corresponding with what you saw when you arrived, because you say, well, it's I didn't have any sight at all inside. There was no visibility at all. But here, according to the simulations, there could have been some visibility underneath the smoke layer. So that means that something about mass production is much worse than we assumed here in the model. Yeah, that,
and the printer inked.
And the printer ink, maybe, yeah. So this, again, is a fuel-controlled fire in a pre-flash over situation, no high pressure in the compartment. Low interface height, okay, but not very low. Here again, entering fire compartment is possible. So creating an opening, well, because it's fuel controlled, means that creating an opening is possible without very large consequences. So you could do that in this case.
If you know what's inside. If you don't know what's inside,
No.
It might be a surprise. We don't know. That's the problem we have. But we talked about that.
So you have to be pretty sure about that. But on the other hand, what is the risk when it was a rack storage that was completely filled with fire load? That's the next simulation. You see here the assumptions, uniformly distributed cellulose fire, ultra-fast fire development because of rack storage. We assume an ultra-fast development. Fire starts at 3 meters above floor and rate of heat release density of 1500 kilowatts per square meter.
And maybe somebody thinks why it starts 3 meters above floor, but we had a fire in a storage building like this and they put a pellet bag with cigarette lighters on it and one box fell off and the pellet was on top of the lighters and there was a fire. So don't think it doesn't happen. In reality, it happens.
Yeah, it can happen at every level, but so this is, okay, it's just an assumption. I tried also other levels of fire start that doesn't really have a big influence in this case, because with that very fast fire development, you get also a very fast flashover moment. Already after 6 to 7 minutes, we reach the flashover. In this case, because of the temperatures, the temperature at 300 degrees Celsius gets in contact with the fire load in the rack storage, and then we get flashover. But what you also see is that it's kind of peak temperature and is immediately decreased, apparently, I think, because of lack of oxygen. You can see that also on the rate of heat release. So this is the moment of flashover, so the rate of heat release rises then. And in theory, rises far outside this graph, so to let's say several hundreds of megawatts. But that's not possible because of lack of oxygen, and that's what you see here. So this is the rate of heat release that is possible with the air leakage that is here in the separation construction. So more or less constant level. And that means that this is an oxygen-controlled fire, after flashover at least. So when you make an opening, and that's what Joost meant, if you don't know what's inside the compartment, if it's a completely filled rack storage and then it's a ventilation-controlled fire and you make an opening in the separation construction,
We have to go on because of the time, so that's
nice. Okay. Maybe I'll go.
I want to know if I make when I go send my crew in. I say open the door and watch what happens. But if you say open the door, it might be a big door they open because sometimes they are not so. Somebody thinks, oh, okay, I open the door. I open the big door. Normally, I open the big door and everything is okay. Yeah. So, Ruud, they open the door 4 by 4 square meters. What will happen?
Yeah, what will happen? Well, maybe good to know about this, that the pressure at floor level is a very high under pressure at floor level. The pressure in the compartment is not high compared to the pressure outside, but the pressure difference in height is a large pressure difference. That means that the low height openings, that there really is sucking air inside and the openings very high in a compartment, there is there are really a lot of pressure to move the smoke outside. So you could see that, I think. That's okay. Well, we make an opening, a large opening, and we open it after 10 minutes. So that is after flashover, because you don't know if flashover already happens. And let's suppose that you are there after 10 minutes, and that's what you see here. This is the temperature graph. Yeah. So here you see this is a temperature graph that we had before, and then suddenly there is an opening. You see that the temperature rises, and that's of course because the rate of heat release rises. the rate of heat release by creating an opening goes from 45 megawatts to, well, 85 megawatts. So that's a huge increase of heat.
Ruud, I think when they open the big door, they see the smoke coming out really fast.
Yeah.
Faster and faster and faster. This is a nice indication, and I hope they can close it. But in reality, I think we are too late.
But on the other hand, Joost, if you don't open the door, then it's you are after flash over. You can do nothing. Yeah. If you open the door, you see that the temperature rises and the rate of heat release rises. But what are the consequences then? Well, maybe the higher temperatures means that there is a higher risk of collapsing of the steel structure or collapsing of compartment
walls. In this case,
walls.
It was a fireproof door. Yeah. Double fireproof door. So maybe if you open fireproof...
But it also was a steel structure also. Yeah. So I hope that the steel structure of this compartment is independent from the steel structure of the other compartment then. Because then it's possible. Yeah. Then it's allowed to collapse this for collapsing this steel structure. So the consequences are only consequences in temperature and thermal load. And that might you could just try it, because if you don't know, open the door. If you see a lot of air transport coming in and smoke coming out, then close the door immediately.
Okay, but hold on to the door, because I have some examples that people open the door and they lose the door, and the door goes open, the fire goes in, roll over, flash over, and that wasn't possible anymore to close the door. So if you do it, hold tight, hold the door tight.
Yeah. Because it would be nice to open a smaller door then.
I got a video of a door with a door, how you call it, when the door automatically closes, the door, self-closing door, but the self-closing door is opened by the air sucked in. So you know how much pressure is behind it.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's could
really
happen.
With a high velocity then, Okay. So a huge increase of rate of heat release by opening a door means increase of gas temperature. Not really differences in consequences in the fire compartment, but we already had high temperatures. Okay, they become higher. For a steel structure means that risk of collapse is a bit higher than that, but I think you should assume also when you don't open the door that if there is a non-fire resistant load-bearing structure, that it will collapse also. So that basically not relatively a difference. I think you must be aware of maybe a large external flame in the opening that you make in a compartment. So
that's why if you make an opening, do it on a safe place when you can catch the fire if it's going somewhere else. I think we have to go to the conclusions.
Yeah. In this case, it's the same as the first case. Just realize at what stage do we arrive, or what stage of the fire do we arrive? Is it a pre-flash over fire or a post-flash over fire? Especially in post-flash over fire, is it an oxygen controlled fire? In most cases, it will be. And that means that in that case, there are consequences of creating openings, because then creating openings means that you have an impact on the rate of heat release and also an impact on gas temperatures and interface height or visibility, whatever. We cannot give a standard strategy for this case, because it's depending on building and on fire in the building. So that's the difficulty in this case.
We skip this one. There's a video about the fire in Kootwijkbroek. I already told it's a very nice video. The Fire Service Academy made a new video about it, but it's fire crew goes in, open doors, and every time they open more doors or windows, the fire get worse, and in the end, we have a fire, very dangerous fire inside, and they use crane to open up, and there was a real nice fire coming out of it, but
yeah, this is basically the same as the last simulation. Eh? So that, okay.
We see when you have storage buildings. This was also a storage building, and you see gray, yellow smoke coming out and pushed out, and it's a storage building. It tells you something about the fire inside. It's bigger. It's getting bigger, and it's once air. It's a different kind of fire when you arrive than a garage on fire. It's black smoke. Slowly coming out, and if it's coming out faster, you know, there are a lot of pyrolyse, paralyzes
it's
heating up and waiting for oxygen.
That's true. That the smoke in a ventilation controlled fire is always combustible. Okay. That's
so we have to go to the
final conclusions. I think. Without information about building and fuel or fire characteristics, it's not possible to forecast a fire scenario. That sounds logical, but that's really the problem when you arrive at the scene. Because then, if you don't know that, then it's also difficult to control the fire in an efficient way or in a safe way even. So that you have to know something. And I think about the building, you can do some estimations that are very plausible at the scene. The fire load inside is more difficult, I think. But if you know something about the building function, and if you make an opening and watch what happens, then you can react in, I think, the right way on that. And I think what we did together is normally I'm a fire engineer. That means that I'm engineering buildings for especially personal safety for the building occupants. I'm using models for that because I'm always engineering buildings that are not comply to the building code. We can use the same techniques for fire suppression, and that's the field of experience from Joost. And so that was very nice to cooperate for this workshop together.
It's really when you talk to fire crews and talk about the fire, and you can tell them something about why did the fire develop this way? What was the influence of your firefighting activities? It helps to understand what happened. If you don't know what happened, you cannot learn from it. So I hope the fire investigators, there's two now, but one from a private company and one from a fire department, go to your colleagues and ask them, can we work together to make a simulation of the fire? So you can teach fire crews, or you can show fire crews what's happening when you open doors, etc., etc. If you need help or you have a nice case, go contact Fire Service Academy. Call me, call Ruud, Thijs, Liebe of René. Oh, dan hebben we ook nog Ricardo. Sorry, Ricardo. We are looking for cases like that, and we want to make cases and share them with the Fire Service of the Netherlands, so we can learn together. Are there any questions after this? Oh, a question.
With building regulation in the Netherlands, the building must facilitate the fire brigade to look for people, and also to make it possible
to rescue
effective compression of the fire itself. Okay. At the compartment. Is it possible to use simulation to predict if it's possible to do more than only look at the outside and do nothing?
Ooh, is it so that the building regulations in the Netherlands says we have to go in and to rescue?
No.
But only the what's inside is we have to go in. We have to park nearby, 40 meters in front of the door. We have we need water, and then it's good luck inside. The building regulations.
But we have preventive measures for safety of the building occupants to realize safe escape routes, and you can also use the safe escape routes as safe attack routes, because they are fire resistant enough to also mean something.
Okay, but in the fire compartment, there are. I was talking about thinking about the fire in the fire compartment, and you can go safe to that compartment.
Yeah, industrial buildings might collapse according to the building code, but when you have multi-story buildings, then we have of course a fire resistance on load-bearing elements, and that is much more than the fire resistance of compartments. So you may assume that it's still possible to go inside the building, maybe not to go inside the fire compartment, but what you call, how is that called, preventive indoor attack?
Offensieve binnenaanval,
defensive indoor attack. So you go inside the building, but not in the fire compartment. So then you can cool separation constructions and try to keep the fire inside that compartment.
But the problem is our firewalls don't keep smoke out. So the smoke is in the room where you are fighting the fire, admission where you are, and there's still a danger of smoke gas ignition. But if you went to the workshop yesterday of Liwe, you told something more about that. Another question? Then thank you very much. Yeah. And I hope to see you
at the drinks. Yeah, I think that's the only part of the program left now.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.